السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم التنزيل بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. صدق الله العظيم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: يد الله مع الجماعة، أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, in today's khutbah, which I would like to briefly discuss, is with regard to the unity and how the Muslims could understand each other and have a peaceful environment firstly amongst themselves. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to this world as a messenger, Arabians had so much of different ideologies, different trends, different way of lifestyle. And they used to have so much of problem in them, and they did not have proper peace in their life. One of the greatest problems which the Arabs had to confront during the times of Jahiliyyah, that they used to have hatred amongst themselves. They used to give more importance to their tribes, and they used to neglect the brotherhood amongst them. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, to show an example for this, we see it is mentioned in history that there were two men who belonged to two different tribes, and one of their she camels grazed in the land of the other. Because the she camel grazed in the other person's land, they couldn't bear it. They had to wage war just because of this mere small slight incident for 40 years. For 40 years they waged war because of one minor incident where she camel grazes in another person's plot of land. So brothers and elders in Islam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent in a time when he had to bring the brotherhood amongst the people he was living with. So when Islam came in, it was able to bring all of them under one flag. And because of that, we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Allah addresses the Sahaba and he says, hold on to the rope of Allah severely or firmly. And thereafter he says, وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And do not split or do not divide into different sects and groups. And after that he says, وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. He addresses the Sahaba and he says, remember the bounty of Allah, remember the blessing of Allah which He poured upon you. وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً. Remember there was a time when both of you used to be enemies amongst you, and you used to fight for trivial issues. Remember the time when you were enemies. فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. And Allah brought that mutual understanding and united all of you together. فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. And after that, due to the blessing of Allah, you became brothers of Islam. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, when we see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he migrated to Medina, the first thing what he did was he paired the Sahabas. He paired the Ansaris with the Muhajirs. And he asked the Ansaris to help the Muhajirs out. So brotherhood was established. And in the inception, from the time Islam began in Medina. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, it is very important that as Muslims we should maintain unity amongst ourselves, whether it is in community wise or whether it is in our own families as well. Today we see, maybe we are a family living under one roof, traveling in the same vehicle. But when we speak to the individuals in that particular family, we will see that their hearts are not united. Their hearts are not united. But outwardly, the world will envy the life they are living. They will imagine this couple goes in the car and they are well off, and they start envying the couple. But whereas outwardly, we can see that both of them are in the same vehicle, but their hearts are not united together. And whereas when you take it in a larger scale, today we are confronting with that problem where at times the Muslims amongst themselves do not have unity. So respected brothers and elders in Islam, it is very important that we have to develop the sifat of loving our brother Muslim, caring our Muslim brother, and forget the faults and shortcomings whatever happened from their side. So Islam never encourages us to have disputes, arguments, controversies and all that. Because by the moment we have that in our lives, what happens is, it is going to affect our religion, our Islam, our Iman, and that impact cannot be rectified in any manner. It cannot be rectified in any manner. Maybe we have some sort of shortcomings with the relationship with Allah, maybe we don't perform our salah on time, or we have some sort of a problem there. But when it comes to the relationship with the creation, the servants of Allah, and especially the Muslims, if we are not able to have, if we cannot have a proper relationship between those who are living with us, it means we have not achieved the perfect level of Iman. So brothers and elders in Islam, when we take the life of the Sahaba, there were Arabs, there were non-Arabs, there were Persians, there were Romans, there were free men, there were slaves, there were rich men, there were poor men. There were so many different types of people living. But the best part was, even though they belonged to different countries, different tribes, different clans, whatever, but when it came to masjid, when they came to the masjid, all of them stood in the same row. Nobody had a priority over the other brother. The Arab did not have more preference than a non-Arab. We see Hazrat Bilal radiallahu anhu, he wasn't an Arab, he was an Abyssinian slave. But Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam chose him to be the first muallim of Islam. But we never come across in history that the Arabs, the Sahaba spoke bad about that. Why come Nabi cannot appoint an Arab from our tribes, and this black slave from outside comes from nowhere and he becomes the first muallim of Islam? No. And whereas we see at times, people like Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu, he accepted Islam during the conquest of Makkah, which occurred nearly the 8th Hijri. When the conquest of Makkah took place, before that, it is mentioned that he was an enemy to Islam. He used to plot and plan against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, against Islam. He was planning to destroy Islam, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to the correct path. So we see when Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu accepts Islam, he needs to come to the masjid and he has to pray with the fellow Muslims. So remember brothers, the ayat which I have recited before you, Allah says that he is the one, it is Allah who joined the hearts of the Sahaba. So this Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu, he might be praying in the masjid, but the person next to him will be the son of a man whom Abu Sufyan has already killed sometime back. But due to the ni'mat of Islam, they became united. They became united because of Islam. But the saddest part today is, brothers, it is with the name of Islam that we find so many divisions and so many groups in our own community. We have misunderstandings amongst us. We have not understood that the difference we are having is regarding some minor issue. But due to this minor issue, we are not even prepared to speak to our Muslim brother or smile at him or even say salam at times. But whereas Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they used to have difference of opinion amongst them, but they used to be united. Brothers and elders in Islam, we see a person gets hatred in his heart the moment his Iman is weak. But when you look into the life of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he used to interact with the Sahaba, he was a man who used to think very far and wide. He was a person who had insight in him. We see that the Quraysh of Makkah, since Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam started to propagate Islam, they never showed any help. They didn't show their help, or they always wanted to harm the Prophet and his companions. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, after suffering for nearly 12 years, he migrates to Medina. He migrates to Medina. And 2 years later, after migration, the Battle of Uhud takes place. And this Battle of Uhud is against those kuffar of Makkah. So these kuffar in Makkah, they plotted and they planned against Nabi to the extent that they were even ready to kill Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the enemies which the Muslim army are going to confront in the Battle of Uhud are the Quraysh of Makkah, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam leads the army. So when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes, and all of us know that one of the fierce battles in the history of Islam, where the Muslims had to undergo defeat, they had to meet defeat because of one thing which I would like to tell later on. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, during this battle, when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam broke his tooth, his Mubarak face was injured by the kuffar. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu, his hand was paralyzed because he was guarding Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Such a fierce battle which took place. But even though the kuffar were attacking Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this way, he did not have an ill feeling regarding them. What did he say? He said, "Ya Allah, forgive them, they do not know the truth." The bitter enemies of Islam, this was how Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam interacted with him. Allahu Akbar. He made dua, "Ya Allah, they do not understand the truth. Ya Allah, guide them to the correct path." This was the dua of Nabi. Same thing happens in Taif. When they did not welcome him, when they did not accept the message which Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with, what did they do? They did not chase him away. They pelted stones upon him. When Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam left Taif, he was bleeding. But in spite of all that difficulty, he never cursed the ummah, because he loved them. So brothers and elders in Islam, it is very important. We must keep it in mind. Maybe we have different groups and divisions in our community, but all these are just basically minor differences. There are differences of opinions amongst the a'imma. So different people have different opinions. Just because there are so many groups, that doesn't mean that we think it is only we who are correct and you are wrong. At times people, they call others wrong and they expect that they are only correct. They think that they are the only ones who are going to enter Jannah. But brothers, don't forget that the Muslim brother whom we hate from our own hearts, don't forget he is accepting the same Allah. He believes in the same Allah. He believes in the same Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He has brought iman in the same Anbiya. He has believed in the Quran. He is reciting the Quran. He is practicing according to the Quran. He is facing the same Qibla as we are doing. He has accepted, he has believed in Jannat and Jahannam. He has accepted that there is a life after death. When all these things are common amongst us, why do we need to have so many problems? Why can't we be united? When we take, for an example, those who are non-Muslims, amongst them they have got so many groups. Amongst their religion they have got so many groups. But they know that the other person is following, they are having a wrong belief. It is totally out of their aqidah, according to their religion. But still yet, they do not expose it to the world, but rather they are ready to live unitedly. But they will have the difference of opinion amongst them. But respected brothers and elders in Islam, when you look into the lives of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they too had difference of opinion. And before I mention that, with regard to Uhud, why did the Sahaba radiallahu anhum had to face that defeat? What was the reason for that defeat? We see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, "It is because of you, it is from your own hands that you had to accept the defeat. You had to lose that battle because of your own actions." What was the action? It is because you people disputed amongst yourselves. The Amir who was appointed in the mountain, he said to the companions with him, don't leave this place, don't leave the station position of Nabi. He asked us to stay here. But what did they do? They said, "No, Nabi meant that we have to be here till the battle is over. But we see everything is okay, Muslims are victorious now. It's time for us to go and collect the booty." So they thought like that, and they went forward and took the booty. But Khalid ibn Walid, who accepted Islam later on, he was leading the kuffar. He came and attacked, and Muslims had to face a defeat. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, what was the main cause there? It was the dispute. It was a misunderstanding which took place amongst the Muslims. Let us take an example of a rope. Rope which is made out of coconut husk. When we take one cord of a rope, for an example, one string, it is very easy for us to break it without any difficulty if there is only one husk, one piece of string. But the moment we add string after string, when we make it 1,000 strings or 2,000 strings, and the moment we make it a rope, even if there are 1,000 men who are ready to split it apart, it will not be, they will not be able to do that. Because ropes have got together, these strings have got together and made a very strong rope. And it is not possible for anybody to bring a split in this rope. Brothers and elders in Islam, if this ummah is spread into different groups and different sects, and they think that the opinion they hold is the correct one, it is the same example which will apply to them as well. If we are not ready to unite ourselves and to stay as one rope or a bundle, respected brothers and elders in Islam, Allah knows best what is going to lie in our future. When we look into the lives of the Sahaba, after the Battle of Ahzab, which took place in the 5th year of Hijri, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam returns to Medina, and Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam commands him. He says, "Ya Rasulullah, we have still, the battles are not over, the fight is not over yet. We have to go to Banu Qurayza." And he mentions to send a group of Sahaba there. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to his companions, to the army he was dispatching, he said, "You have to perform your Asr Salah after you reach Banu Qurayza." It is one of the well-known incidents. So Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they started their journey, and on their way, the time for Asr approached. And some of the Sahabis said, they spoke amongst themselves, they had two groups there. A group said, "It is time up that we pray Salatul Asr, because if we don't pray Salatul Asr now, we are going to miss the Salah, because Maghrib is in the corner, it's about to come." So another group of Sahaba said, "No, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked us to pray Salatul Asr after we reach Banu Qurayza. So even if we reach after Maghrib, it doesn't matter, we'll pray our Salat there." So they had this slight argument, but the Sahabas, a group of Sahabas prayed before they reached Banu Qurayza, and the other group of Sahabas prayed the Salatul Asr after they had reached Banu Qurayza. So after the expedition was over, and when the Sahabas returned back to Medina, they said to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding whatever happened. We see the teachings of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did not reprimand anyone. He did not scold anyone. He did not say that what you've done is wrong and what you've done is correct. Why did you do this and why didn't you do that? He knew that if he was to handle that situation like that, it is going to be worse, and the ummah is going to be divided into two different groups. He didn't want that to happen. He said both the parties have done the correct thing. So we see amongst the Sahaba too, they had difference of opinion. It is mentioned regarding Imam Shafi rahmatullahi alayhi. Once he was seated with his friend, was a very close friend of his, another Imam, and he started to discuss regarding a mas'ala. So they, both of them started in a very low tone. They were arguing each other. But the moment they started to discuss, and it took some time, they started to raise voice. One started to raise the voice, and Imam Shafi also. Both of them were, basically they were having something similar to an argument. But Imam Shafi rahmatullahi understood that we are going beyond what is needed. But end of the day, nobody accepted their opinion. They had two different opinions. But Imam Shafi rahmatullahi alayhi told his friend, "Maybe we can have difference of opinion regarding a mas'ala, but we still can remain as friends." They had two different opinions, but they said, we can be friends. Maybe we can differ in opinion. Doesn't matter. This was the way the Salafus Salihun, they used to live, brothers. And another example, Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullahi alayhi is one of the famous imams in the field of hadith. He was a man who used to take part in jihad, and he had another friend of his who was an abid, a worshipper. His name was Fudail ibn Iyad. So both of them were very close friends, and they used to be in Haram, in Makkah. So when the time came for Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullahi alayhi to go in path of Allah, to go in jihad, he goes out, and his friend Fudail ibn Iyad, he's in the masjid, worshipping Allah day and night, salat, zikr, Quran, tilawat, fasting. This was his life. Whereas his friend is in jihad. So after a few days, Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullahi alayhi writes a letter to his friend saying, "Ya Abid al-Haramain," a long poem, he writes a poem, he says, "Oh, the one who worships in the Haram, the sanctuary of Haram, know that you're playing with your ibadah. We here in jihad are striving so hard. Our horses are being used in the path of Allah, whereas your horses are used for nothing. You sweat in your ibadah. Our sweat is the blood from our necks." He starts to tell about the deeds they are doing in jihad. The moment Fudayl ibn Iyad rahmatullahi alayhi received this letter. The letter, basically the summary was, Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullahi alayhi says that jihad is far more better than the ibadat in haram. Fudayl ibn Iyad, he was a very pious man. He writes a letter back to Abdullah ibn Mubarak. He did not write any arguments there. He said, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided the a'mal of the son of Adam to different people. Some Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them the talent of fasting, they have the strength. Some can stay awake at night, some recite Quran, some pray. So many different ibadah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided to the ummah. So different people have different strengths and they are striving according to that. So know that both of us are doing something good. So we did not have any argument. This was the way they solved the problem. This was the beautiful manner which the Salafus Salihun solved the ikhtilaf, the contradicting opinions they had amongst themselves. So brothers and elders in Islam, so what we need to do is we need to bring unity in the community. So once there was a group of learned men, they gathered and they wanted to discuss how can we bring unity in the community of the Muslims. It's a very difficult task. So many groups, I belong to this jama'at and I belong to that jama'at, and he says you wrong and the other says you have different opinions. So they discussed for a very long time, but there was a very old man. He had a very nice opinion. He said, you people are discussing of so many things, how you can bring unity in the community, but have you forgotten the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, if you don't stand in the straight line, in the row, in the saf, in the masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not unite the hearts of that people. Leaving this hadith, you're planning about so many other programs and so many other things, you forgot the hadith of Nabi. So brothers and elders in Islam, wherever we are, in the masjid, wherever in any masjid, we need to keep our safs correct, straight, in a proper manner, without any gaps, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring that unity amongst us. And another incident which I remember, brothers and elders in Islam, reading in a book, it is mentioned that there was a Khalifa, he was having the Muhaddithun in front of him. So this Muhaddithun, they started to read Hadith. So the moment one Muhaddith read the Hadith, the other Muhaddith said, the Hadith you read is not authentic. The Hadith which you read now is not authentic. So there was a small argument which was about to rise there. There was a very old man, but he was very wise. He looked at that man who wanted to start the argument, the man who said the hadith was da'if. He said, have you memorized all the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, no, I have not memorized all the hadith. Then the old man asked him, have you memorized half the hadith of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, perhaps I would have memorized it. The old man wanted to put a stop for the argument. He said, consider the hadith which this man has read to be from the half which you have not memorized. Have we encompassed all the hadith of the Prophet? No. So this old man solved the problem in a very nice manner. So finally, to conclude, brothers and elders in Islam, we need to bring unity in our families and also very importantly in our times today. Along with that, we need to be united in the community, because only if we are together, the help of Allah will come. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Yadullahi ma'al jama'ah, the help of Allah is with the group who are united and who are living as brothers. And finally, I would like to leave you with two quotes. One is, the object is not that we should agree. The object is not that we should agree, but rather the object is not to conflict with each other. And the second quote is, there isn't enough time to love in this world. Don't know how people find time to hate others. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
For more lectures, visit slhub.com.